that could very well be a point of research, a point of critical analysis within this part of class. Okay? The question of intervention. Is it legal for one state in this day and age to intervene in the affairs of others? I mean, it happens, but is it legal? Is it right? Should the sovereignty of states be respected? Borders are intangible. Or here's really the more moral reason. Should states, with the power, authority, and ability to halt violence, intervene to halt violence? One of the basic principles of the UN Charter is that states are sovereign and they cannot be just simply randomly and arbitrarily invaded anymore. Okay? We'd like to think that we have come a certain way from the 19th century. And yet, one of the moral questions, not exactly legal, is that if your country sees that there is injustice in another country in the world, famine, ethnic cleansing, genocide, political tyranny, should you, as a country, intervene? Because you know damn well that the United Nations is not going to do anything. And you know damn well that there's no other power in the world. Let's just be perfectly honest. Should the United States intervene? Should the United States have intervened in Somalia to stop the famine? Should the United States have intervened in Rwanda, where it did not? Did the United States have a right to intervene in Bosnia? And yet, the US does not intervene in Turkey. Do the laws of sovereignty give way when issues of human rights are violated? Which means that does legality take a second seat when morality needs to be put into place? Now again, another argument that kind of tugged at the heartstrings of many Americans 15 some odd years ago in the wake of 9/11 and prior to the Iraq invasion is that, you know what, even if Saddam doesn't have weapons of mass destruction, this guy is a tyrant. This guy is a brutal dictator. Wouldn't it be right, not legal, but wouldn't it be right for us to get rid of him? Wouldn't the Iraqi people be happier without him, right? I mean, we saved Europe twice in two world wars. Should we not do the exact same thing? Better yet, how effective really is intervention? Because you can kind of look at something and say, oh my God, I need to get myself involved in that because that's pretty damn, that's pretty bad. But how effective is intervention? When we look at the track record of one country intervening in another, have things actually gotten any better? Or do we go to what I was saying on Monday? Intervention effectively stops the killing, but it does little by ways of reconciliation. It does little by ways of promoting peace. Right? Are the goals of the international community achieved? You have to also ask yourself this, what are the goals? You decide to intervene, what are you doing? Are you intervening to bring a better government to a particular country? Or are you intervening just simply to stop the violence? We don't want to see people getting killed on the 6 o'clock evening news. Probably the most poignant example, there are two examples that come out of this in the 1990s. You gotta remember, this is the CNN effect. Number one, in the civil wars that collapsed Yugoslavia, you have a whole bunch of emaciated prisoners of war behind barbed wire fences. And the first thing that comes to our mind when we see that is, oh shit, there's concentration camps in Europe again. You cannot stand by and allow that to happen. The second one that you see, roughly around the same time, is the mass famine in Somalia. Now, we're kind of, at this point, almost numb to looking at pictures of starving African children. And that's a sad thing. But when you look at people who are basically walking skeletons, when you see children who are so weak from hunger that they can't even swat the flies from sitting in their eyes, do you sit back on your big fat couch eating your supersized meal and do nothing? Or do you feel, we've got to do something about that? For God's sake, we're America. This is the United States. We help out. If you feel that the United States should get itself involved, congratulations, you've nominated yourself as world police. Once you do that, you've got yourselves a number of commitments to do. What do you do? Okay. This is taken directly from your Nye reading. There's various degrees of intervention, ranging from the, ooh, I've made a speech on Facebook, look at me, I'm so awesome, I've spoken out against Starbucks coffee cups. So speeches, broadcasts, that's really nothing. Economic aid, military advisors, this is kind of like where we are with Syria right about now. You know, we just need to, you know, make to give the impression that we're actually doing something. But blockade, limited military action, and boots on the ground, this is the thing. If your understanding of intervention falls on this side of the coin, congratulations, realism still wins. Realism still wins. If you can actually make one hell of a speech where you're just kind of like, dude, ISIS, you're doing stupid things. If I can come up with a speech where suddenly Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi is like, oh, you're right, I really don't know what Islam is. I'm just going to go home and say I'm sorry. Okay? Like, if I can get ISIS to kind of be like, oops, wow, we really screwed that one up. Congratulations, but that's not going to happen. What's the best, what do you think today? How are we going to get rid of ISIS? How are we going to finally defeat ISIS? What's probably the most non-confrontational way of defeating ISIS? Let's start with that. What's probably the most non-confrontational could we possibly do?
Cut off their money source, stop buying oil from the countries that fund them.
One very poignant way, one very effective way of counterterrorism these days is actually playing the Rudy Giuliani card. And that is before he became a nutball running for president. This is when he was a pretty awesome mayor of New York City. And that is cutting off the money. Cut off the money, you starve them. As a matter of fact, that's probably a quicker way than just letting them eat themselves alive. Here's the problem. Where do you cut off the money? Where do you go after? We're talking about money that is everywhere and anywhere. Okay? What else could you possibly do? How many people would say a couple of daisy cutters and boots on the ground and, you know, Team America, World Police, America, fuck you, would probably solve the problem? You know, just cue up the G.I. Joe cartoon theme song and let's give these people some freedom. Okay? It could work, but you need a lot of bombs. You need a lot of troops, and you need a relentless, relentless military campaign. How costly is that going to be? And, more importantly, when you use the military, you cannot just simply leave the country after you have achieved your military objective. That's the problem that we had with Iraq 2003. They didn't have enough boots on the ground to stabilize the area. So intervention is more than just simply active combat. Intervention is a long-term investment that also involves building the region back up to a level where this type of stuff does not happen again. Okay? How about this one? When do we intervene? When and where? When and where do we intervene? Now, do states have the right? Do states have the right to prevent ethnic cleansing and genocide? Yes, we do. We cannot allow another Holocaust. We said never again in 1945, and we're going to stick to it. No, we can't be the world police. We can't be everywhere and anywhere, because eventually we're going to run out of resources, and we're effectively going to become, the ruler of the world. Why is it that some countries decide to give a damn about these things in one place and choose to just simply ignore it elsewhere? Why Bosnia and not Rwanda? Why did the United States finally get Europe to mobilize and get active in Bosnia? And why did we not do a single thing in Rwanda? It's a rhetorical question, but Adam, go ahead and really, really depress me.
Because France is actively supporting the genocide of the government, and the French army is actually guarding the border and carrying out the genocide, so that's why the European states and the United States all along.
Are you actually implementing the French and doing something dastardly? He's nodding his head. That's a bit more of a specific answer than I would have gone with, but yes, you're correct. There's another reason why we didn't intervene in Rwanda. Nick?
After Black Hawk Down, there was
By the way, let me just pause. You all know what Black Hawk Down, not the movie. Okay, well, it was a rather good movie. What is exactly Black Hawk Down?
It was like a failure of a rescue or a mission in Mogadishu in Somalia, right? And a helicopter got shot down by terrorists there. So there was like a public backlash against intervening in Africa, basically.
There's a public backlash against intervening in Africa, as ridiculously insensitive as this sounds. Oh, it's in Africa. Fuck it. Don't laugh at that, but you can't not laugh at that. No, you're absolutely right. The Somalia incident, as soon as Black Hawk Down happens, we're like, screw it, we're out of here. We packed up and we left. 2 years later, Rwanda, 1994. Oh yeah, Africa, remember Somalia? Right, fuck it. Why Bosnia? Because Bosnia is in Europe. We cannot stand to see ethnic cleansing in Europe. In Africa, well, you know, that just comes with the monsoon season. Okay? So why do we choose to intervene? In effect, there's two general answers. One answer is just simply intervention in some cases is much more vital, is much more important to the intervening country's national security and national interest. And the other one is that, as Adam correctly points out, there is at least one major country that is actively preventing the global community from intervening. Which means that we go back to national interest. We go back to, once again, might makes right. I have the diplomatic clout, I have the military, I've got the votes, I've got the threat of a UN veto trying to make this thing happen. Okay, let's forget military intervention. How about we just simply go with economic sanctions? That's kind of like the long, more drawn out way. I'm gonna get myself involved. I don't wanna feel guilty for not doing anything, but I don't wanna put boots on the ground in this godforsaken armpit of the planet. So I'm just simply gonna isolate it economically. Do sanctions work? Do sanctions work? 9 times out of 10, no they don't. Because the regime in power will always find ways of getting money. We put Iraq under sanctions for more than 10 years. The Iraqi population suffers. Saddam Hussein went to bed with a full stomach every night. As a matter of fact, Saddam Hussein's inner clique became exponentially wealthy between Gulf War I and Gulf War II. The guy is giving solid gold AK-47s to his bratty kids on their birthdays. That kind of tells you that there is a lot more bling than we would expect a sanctioned government to have. Not only that, but one of the beautiful things about capitalism is that people will always find ways of getting what they want. Sanctions simply open the door to the black market, and smugglers rejoice. You may have heard in the recesses of American history that we tried at one point, less than a century ago, we tried, rather unsuccessfully, of prohibiting one particular popular vice in this country. Alcohol. And the minute that prohibition goes into effect, organized crime rejoices. Rejoices. And Joseph Kennedy goes from the head of an extremely dysfunctional Irish family to, a few years later, the head of an extremely dysfunctional, rich, and politically connected Irish family. Okay? So the black market provides all sorts of ingenuity, especially when we look at the age of globalization, right? Borders do not stop people from getting what they want. What about this one? How about if intervention does take place and the bad guys are captured or the war is lost? Do certain states have the right to pursue international criminals? This is something that's been effectively a debate of international legal studies ever since Nuremberg, 1946. Do countries that win wars have the right to put the losing side on trial? Or is it just simply a case of victor's justice? Did you really, really, really think that if you captured Hitler and you put him on trial, did you really think he'd get off on a technicality? Like, did you really think that? You put Saddam Hussein on trial, you think he's gonna get off because the glove didn't fit? No, of course not. But why do you do this? Why do you go with war crimes tribunals? Probably the best answer to that is the war crimes trial of a rather infamous Nazi, Adolf Eichmann. Adolf Eichmann was captured by Israeli secret agents in South America in the 1960s. This is pretty badass, if you want my opinion. Adolf Eichmann was one of the major architects of the Holocaust. Right? The Wannsee Conference, like his name was on all the documents. He fled Germany at the end of the Second World War and hid out in South America, which was basically a safe haven for all sorts of sordid fascists from the Second World War. The Mossad finds out where he's located. They capture him, they bring him back to Jerusalem. They put him on trial. Now most people are like, okay, look, first of all, the fact that these Israelis didn't shoot this guy in the streets is testament enough to how mature they are. But they put the guy on trial, and he's kind of looking at them saying, dude, why are you wasting your time? Like, for God's sake, I tried to systematically exterminate your group of people. You're putting me on trial. I kind of know how this movie's gonna end. The Israeli court basically says, no. Now, the reason why we're putting you on trial is not because we're gonna give you this thought that you're gonna get out of this, but we're going to set a legal precedent for why we are doing what we're doing. Why what you did is not just giving us an excuse to get revenge. This is not revenge. This is a legal precedent. This is a legal precedent for what constitutes a war crime. And at some point down the road, when something similar to this happens, they're gonna be pointing to this case as to why it is legally imperative that states use the enforceability of their own sovereignty and their own legal system to back up and uphold principles of international law. So when we talk about war crimes trials, we are specifically talking about the idea of people being put on trial and being found guilty or innocent against principles of international law that adhere to human rights, the sovereignty of states, and the general principles of philosophical liberalism. For the first time in the last few decades, we have found that liberalism as a philosophy is now being used as legal precedents for deciding which countries do good and which ones do wrong. Still, does the United States have the right to invade countries and set that precedent? Did the United States have the right to invade Iraq in 2003? Should the United States have invaded Syria last year? Not so much this is a yes or no question, but this question raises another very delicate question. If the United States has the rights, or it feels that it just simply has the ability, let me just take a step back here. It's a couple of years ago, this is about 10 years ago. I'm in grad school, which surprisingly is here. And I'm sitting in this graduate seminar. It's called American Foreign Policy. And we had a whole bunch of students at the time, American, international. We had students from Germany, we had students from Korea, we had a student from Russia, this, that, and the other. And this is shortly before the Iraq War comes up. So this is 2002, early 2003. And the question for the seminar at the time was, it's not a question of if the United States invades Iraq, but when the United States invades, what is going to be the reason behind it? And we sat there for an entire seminar, basically talking about what the U.S. is going to do to find a way of invading, or trying to find a way, excuse to invade Iraq. And the international students in the seminar were getting visibly uncomfortable. And Germans, Russians, Koreans, until finally there was one German student, raised his hand. And he doesn't even raise his hand, he gets visibly upset. He basically says in so many words, I cannot believe that you people are actually talking about this as if the United States is the arbiter of what goes on in the world. I can't believe that you're actually talking about this. There are laws, there are precedents, there's the United Nations. Why are you talking about this? And another student, I didn't say it, but I was like, good for you, another American student basically looked at him and said, in so many words, because we can. Because we can. And dead silence in the room. Just like, oh shit, he's right. You know? Because we can. We have the guns, we have the power, we have the clout, we have the money, we have everything. Fuck it. We can do it. There's very few countries in the world the United States really can't invade. China is number one, just because it's too damn big. Russia is number two, because you just freeze to death before the Russians do. But that's basically about it. Could the United States, if they really wanted to, could we topple North Korea? We could have this thing over within a week. Even less so. Could we? Of course we could. We could invade and we could conquer. We're very good at conquering countries. We're horrible at putting them back together again, but we're very good at conquering countries. Okay? Here's the thing though. If we say we can, this is the question that I'm going to. If we say, of course we can, we have the guns, we have the clout, we have this, we have that. Are there not other countries in the world besides the United States that have similar capabilities? Are there not other countries that can do the exact same thing? I can think of two. I can think of Russia, because they have. And I can think of China, because they could. Do you want to know why we have not mobilized against North Korea just yet? One very important reason. We have not mobilized against North Korea because by mobilizing against North Korea, that will force the Chinese to mobilize before us. Chinese will take North Korea before we do. And they don't want it. They don't want to be forced into that war. They can do it. Chinese army can do it. Can China take Taiwan? Take Taiwan in 12 hours. Okay? So if the United States says we can do this, does that then open up the door to other countries? If the United States can invade Iraq, can't Russia invade Georgia? Can't Russia intervene in Ukraine? Can't Russia intervene in Syria? That's the best one. Russia intervenes in Syria, John Kerry's like, you can't just go and intervene in countries without international law. It's like, you actually take yourself seriously. That's hilarious.
Didn't Russia just deploy 4,000 troops?
Yeah. They're on the ground. And, you know, I can picture Putin right now. What are you going to do about it? I mean, really, what are you going to do? Hey, America, you're upset? I know you're upset. You're going to go to war with Russia? You're going to risk that? Are you going to risk war with Russia over Ukraine? Is it worth that to you? No. You're going to risk war with Russia over Georgia? Is it worth it? No. So at the end of the day, does realism once again rear its ugly head? Because, simply because of the fact that the international community says one thing, but enforceability is still on the side of great powers.